It's 10 a.m. in Berlin, and today I'm showing you the Königgalerie St. Agnes sale room or showroom. I'm not so sure how much we see in the back here because it's so bright. Oh, here we are. So now you see the bell tower of St. Agnes, which hopefully will be at some point. Okay, here we go. So this is a gallery, and it consists of the chapel, which is this space over here, the nave, which is on the top, and the viewing room, which I'm going to show you. This building here was built by Werner Düttmann. This is a sculpture by Claudia Comte. The building was built by Werner Düttmann from 1964 to 1967, and it's surrounded by buildings from the 50s, because this entire area here was bombed completely flat in the Second World War in 1945, just before the war ended. Werner Düttmann was not only a private architect who in this case built in the style of brutalism, he was also the city head of city department, city planning, head of department. And he not only this landmark, he also built the Brücke Museum, the Akademie der Künste. Now it's better. He convinced Mies van der Rohe to build National Gallery, and now we're in the viewing room, sale room. And I show you now how the church looked. Oh, and there can be questions asked meanwhile. I switched off the comments so you see more of the pictures. So we were here, and very important is the courtyard, because it changed like church architecture. Before, the main space was always so important. Now it's like where the community comes together. Interesting is that when we acquired the building, we did not need to keep the cross. It had a cross, a big cross like this, and we were allowed to take it down because the architect went so far over budget that the community had no money for any decoration. You know, they had no this cross, this Jesus figure on the cross. Werner Düttmann brought it to Berlin from his Tuscany summer holiday in his Porsche, in the back of his Porsche. So there was no receipt filed for this cross. It's kind of dubious sources where it's coming from. Very interesting were these by Werner Düttmann designed church benches, which looked like Donald Judd sculptures. So we are in 1967 here. And you see here, this was a space as it used to be, and we built this in. So Arno Brandelhuber, an amazing Berlin architect, had this idea. He also pointed this building to us. So, and you see this balustrade was for protecting the chorus, you know. So here you see the church on its opening day when it was inaugurated. Back then churches were full. We are in Kreuzberg here, which is a very Turkish Muslim neighborhood. We are in the city center, so the geographical middle point of the city is right in front of the gallery. So here you see how it used to look, and now we have it like this. Actually, it's more or less a similar view. No, not really, it's over there. So, but interesting is he extended the table just here, and you can see up to the room, you see? So it was like, it's not touching the wall, because it's a listed building. It's considered one of the most important brutalist buildings in Germany. Brutalism means that you see the material which is used. Brut comes from concrete. So you see these stones, for example. These stones are from destroyed bombed buildings. So Werner Düttmann had them collect and resurrect. And so also the stucco here is the pure material. It's not painted. It's very honest. I love brutalism. And as Arno puts it always, it's beautiful. So here was the organ, but also again, Werner Düttmann was so way over budget that the church had no organ for the first two decades. The organ is now in St. Bonifatius Church. They took it with them when we took over the building. Here you see it in the context of the neighborhood. This is the London Gallery. So this is so much to introducing where we are right now. Maybe we're going to do a more extensive tour on the architecture at some point. But now let me start with a viewing room. So I'm going to pick out some pieces I think are particularly interesting. So let's start here with Andreas Schmitten, who is a sculptor from Düsseldorf, and he is living in Düsseldorf, and he studied in Düsseldorf with Georg Herold. And interesting with his work actually is that because Georg Herold works with wood elements and not so chic surfaces, and here in this case, Andreas works with stainless steel, and it's a triptych of three vitrines made with glass, stainless steel, and fabric. And inside are these black objects which are sitting on glass shelves that you could see as a jewel box or glasses or coffins. But I think the most likely interpretation are little bags, which you can understand when you take a look at these white objects. They look like fabric, but in fact it's objects on top of them. So they appear to be almost like bed sheets or something. The perfectness and coolness of the surfaces in his work are in opposite to his kind of teacher, but I don't know, maybe I have a thing with this. And of course it's really much standing in the tradition of minimalism, and they appear to be technical or machine-produced objects, but in fact they're all made by his hands. So he's doing all of this himself in the studio. And for example, these bed sheets he's doing, it's like each one is different, and he is heating up synthetic materials to shape them. These three vitrines remind us of window shopping or fridges or something like this, from like presenting goods or being informative elements in skyscrapers or something like this. Andreas kind of creates a figureless, at least in his sculptures, a figureless world. So you don't see people in very controversy to his drawings, where he has where you often see faces, like cool faces, anyway. I also choose this work as a reason for the fact that the figures are missing, and there's no people in it. And like for us today in Corona, it's like presence of absence. Always in his work, it's push and pull, so it's like, kind of like attractive, and also like you left out from it. Maybe interesting is to look at one of the details is like this part here, that you kind of see yourself in it. So then I would continue to Alicia Quade. So here her work is, she had this made together with José Luis, who's a fabricator in Guadalajara in Mexico. And he did these on a turning plate. So they are in fact ceramics, which are lace, and they're painted. And this work was exhibited at the Dallas Contemporary Museum in Dallas. And interesting with this is also like a community, as we are somehow, because it only stands together one leaning to the other, so you can't really, some of them don't stand on them on themselves, and you have to imagine these were coming from turning tables from a ceramic plate. Originally she wanted to do this in glass, but that didn't work out, and I think it's very much also about the movement now. It's 8 objects, and each object is heavier at the bottom to give it stability, and it can be shown outside, but only if they're all together. What else to mention about this? I would say let's move over to Elmgren and Dragset, who are a very known artist duo. Some of you might know from their practice Prada Marfa, which is a sculpture in the desert. So we see two things. On the first glance, they seem identical, but in fact, they are different by this definition here of the soap, which of course plays kind of surprisingly well into our present time. And then they have kind of a very complicated relationship here. It's an historical piece because it's from 2004. So from their not really early, but more early practice. I think actually it's from the time they broke up. They used to be a romantic couple. Now they still are an artistic couple for more than 25 years. And this work here in particular has an amazing exhibition history, because it was just shown at the Nasher and it's published a lot. So let's walk over here to Chiaro Sciota, who is new with the gallery, and I'm very... So with her work, it's she is coming from painting but moved into sculpture after having somewhat of a nightmare, dreaming that she was like eaten up by pain, and she's mostly known for her large scale installations. Also, she represented Japan at the Venice Biennale. Most famous are these installations she did with these keys hanging from a cloud over rustic bones, about 50,000 keys. This work in particular here is made on canvas, and she's using threads and red, what's the name of it? Wool. Not just wool, it's actually. So she's piling up layer after layer and creates a three-dimensional surface on canvases. So you have to imagine this is like thread over thread over thread across the surface. It's a bit like a skin over a body. And the red color she uses is a reference to blood and life and existence of our physical presence. This one she tied with skin, and she kind of makes invisible connections which exist in life between things and people, and I would say that these threads also stand for relationships we have with each other. Then, it's important to point out. Oh, it's a two-part piece, so these are two canvases hung next to each other, which is a work by Rinus van der Velde. And it's kind of interesting, you can't not look at this work without thinking... There was some glitch. You can't look at this large drawing in chalk on canvas by Rinus van der Velde, who's from Belgium, to not think of, pre-Corona times. So we see traders
on the Wall Street probably stock market. Very characteristic for Guido's practice are these texts which he puts under the images, which give his drawings a sort of narrative, which is not necessary. I mean, of course, it's connected, but it's not necessarily. So sometimes he rips it apart. The text has can be very vaguely only connected to the image, and it's more like a hint or decoding the picture. And it's often like an invented figure, which so the voiceover is kind of an eye, which is. Like an avatar of Linus. And crucial part of his work is irony and self-mockery, so it's also like he creates somewhat of an artistic figure of himself. In the coming show in London, in the König London Gallery, we're going to show ashtrays, which are also having a narrative, so it's kind of he's a heavy smoker, and he's supposed to like smoke with these ashtrays and use it. Then last but not least, I want to look at Robert Janitz's painting over here, which Robert Janitz is an artist, he's German born, and he's in his late 50s now, and he lives in New York in Mexico City at this right moment. Robert started comparative religion in Sanskrit, which is important because this is really where the work gets informed. So what we see here are these like big brush strokes, but they are coming from writing, and he went even so far to study paper making to analyze every aspect of the act of writing. The rhythm, the movement in one's hand, but what we see in fact here is as typography. So he would kind of call it the self-portrait of a brushwork itself. It all started with the attempt of depicting texture in Keller, so it's. It's much about the message in one image. So the title A is smaller than 3, L is an allusion on how younger generations are typewriting. And maybe you can see here like the hidden text in it. And the colors he used here are the colors which Robert sees while being in his studio in New York. At sundown, and I think that's interesting because it reminds us of times where solitude was free and not, how would you say, forced on us. So, but I think maybe, that's it. So we looked at Andrea Schmitten, Alicia Quader, Emgrin und Raxit, Chiaro Sciota, and Rinus van der Velde, and at the architecture. And if there are some questions, I'm happy to answer. Is it possible to order this book? I am not sure, because I think we have some copyright issue with this book, so we use it mainly for self-reference here, but we are working on a book on St. Agnes here on the church project. I think it probably comes out in the fall with text by Niklas Mark. I'm not on this project, but great. Jürgen Teller, I think, is going to shoot the building. It's going to be a real artistic book. Also on Dittmann, who is a really legendary architect, and Arno Brandlhuber, of course. Oh, you can't hear me well. Okay, I'm sorry for that. Um,
How many artists do you represent? We represent, I would say, about 30 artists, maybe more, and mainly mid-career and established artists, some estates as well. Oh, sound quality is poor. Okay. I didn't hear that. I'm sorry, I didn't. Externes Mikro. Okay, so I figured, okay, next time I have to do it better then. Did you keep the Donald Judd-like church benches? We did not know. They were given to a Polish community church. And they reused it in a self-built church in Poland. I'm very sorry about the sound. That it would have been an advantage to keep the comments on. The Rhinos van der Velde work costs €60,000 plus VAT. No, we work 50-50. That's how we usually work. Absolutely, yes, we will keep you posted. And in the meanwhile, we have the König magazine, which we are also kind of hoping to come up with a subscription idea. And actually in this first one, with Katharina on the cover, here you see, this is a text by Niklas Mark on Werner Düttmann. And he was really, he was also an artist. So when he painted them, when he executed the building, as I said, they had no money at all. And then, because he overspent it, and then you need a marine figure, you know, like a, and then he painted this painting here. So he did it. So they did not need to buy one. And that's him here. He was a real, you see, and then you see what's next to him? Beer. And this was the Kranzler Egg, which unfortunately got demolished. Yeah. How long have you been working with those artists? It depends. Like Chiaro Chiota, relatively new. I mean, half a year now, maybe. Emre Nodraxet, maybe 5 years now. And Andreas Schmitten also 6. He's not so long out of university. Alicia Quade since many years, more than 10 years. Alicia Quade. I bought a brutalist building. Do you have asbestos issues? Yes, we had pretty serious asbestos issues and also other. The biggest problem was that we had to, because back then labor was very cheap and material was very expensive. So this concrete block here was completely rotten, and we had to restore all the concrete elements, which also this one here, which is a very nice, like a backsack. And that made it so more expensive than we originally assumed. And then also interesting was that we had, when we put this table here, we were not allowed to make fundaments. So all these stands, they just stand on the floor. So they have no foundation. But maybe I'm going to do a full architecture tour because there's so much to say about it. Yeah, sorry for the sound quality. The title of Alicia's piece is... Let me see. Forms of the Universe. Oh, maybe I did not mention this. These are Forms of the Universe, 2019, ceramic glazed, and it's €82,000 and it's unique. Okay. Do you feel a spiritual connection with the building? No, it is. I should flip this questions in first. I do, and what I find is very interesting is, you know, the main purpose of a museum space is space. You know, space at its pure function, but actually only for being space, and that's the same with churches. So that's why I think also they're most popular for architects to build. The building is owned by the St. Agnes company, which is owned by myself and my wife. Let me see. Yes, Alicia Quader. We're gonna make a deep dive into Alicia Quader's work. So we're kind of like open for feedback. If you so not only because of Corona, but we are exploring the possibilities of communicating our artist practice, as we did with the 10 AM series here, where we visited Alicia Quader. So if you haven't seen it, you should go on YouTube and look it up, because it's very amazing how she takes us around her studio. But I think we're gonna do kind of deep dive sessions into certain artists and then explore their practice with experts here from the gallery. The price range is from souvenirs, which you start at €50, and the artists consider them real sculptures, up to, I don't know, 1, 2, 3 million. And we also have Edition König, where we try to make art more available on a wider span. There we have a amazing Norbert Bisky print we just released. I think it nets up at 3,500, an addition of 50. The youngest artist, we are not, you know, it's like interesting. I mean, we started early with Helen Martin, for example, who won the Turner Prize. Well, she's only in her early 30s now. We show her for more than 10 years. But Robert Janitz is not that established, but in his late 50s. So age is not really... Andrea Schmitten is probably was very unknown when we started working with him. I'm more interested in careers and what we can contribute there than in age. So thank you so much. It's kind of a random situation at home, but tonight I'm going to show to art collector Anita Zabludovic on her Instagram Live. So lots of lives happening in all our lives. And tune in, and thanks for watching, and see you very soon.